After Dark is back, coming to you from Bally's Ballroom in Atlantic City, New Jersey. Tonight, a heavyweight doubleheader. First up, Corey Sanders of South Africa, trying to get more active and into the heavyweight contender picture, takes on Haseem Rahman. Then Oleg Maskayev, half a year removed from his spectacular knockout of Rahman, takes on the equally spectacular Derek Jefferson. Springtime on the boardwalk in Atlantic City. Renewal, revival, this weekend, rain. And tonight, boxing fans file into Bally's, hoping to see some heavyweight magic. Will we see the blooming of the next heavyweight hopeful? Or will it be just a night when the pendulum swings back and forth for the heavyweights and everyone here lets it all hang out in pursuit of bigger glory down the road? Hello again, everybody. I'm Jim Lampley. We welcome you to this special edition of HBO's Boxing After Dark. Special because the heavyweights always seem to provide excitement on this telecast, and any of the four men you're about to see could emerge within the next couple of years as a potential contender for the heavyweight crown, or at least all four of them think so. Let's see what our HBO boxing analyst Larry Merchant thinks as we go into the two bouts on the card. Larry, the four heavyweights that we're about to see have an aggregate record of 109 wins, only six losses, 84 knockouts. Not bad. Is there a potential future heavyweight champion among them?
I'd settle for a challenger. There's nothing really cosmic and insignificant about this card, nor do we have a solo concert by a champion. We have four woulda, coulda, shoulda, still mighta heavyweights. And that's a recipe for the meat and potatoes of this game. Competition, risk-taking, perhaps we'll get some drama as well. Jim, if you like your steak raw and your potatoes mashed, this is your kind of night.
Indeed. The heavyweight champion of the world likes Yorkshire pudding, of course, being an Englishman, and working with us as our expert commentator on Boxing After Dark is the man who trains heavyweight titleist Lennox Lewis, the legendary manager and trainer out of Detroit, Emmanuel Stewart. Emmanuel, looking at the four guys we're about to watch in the ring, does one of them intrigue you as a potential future challenger to Lennox?
Well, the one that intrigues me the most, Jim, is Derek Jefferson, because of his explosiveness and his style and the fact that he's never really been beaten, so to say, in his own mind by anyone. He went undefeated in 21 amateur fights and only lost one professional fight, and that was a fight where he really beat himself. So I think he's the most intriguing to me.
And we'll see Jefferson later on in the main event when he takes on Oleg Maskayev. It could be a tremendous matchup in terms of action because both fighters hit and get hit. But meanwhile, let's take a look at Haseem "The Rock" Rahman, who thinks of himself as a potential number one challenger. And indeed, if he had won every fight in which he was leading comfortably on the scorecards, this would be an unbeaten heavyweight. Instead, he's lost twice.
Now, just a year and a half ago, he was fighting for a mandatory spot to fight the heavyweight champion. Now he's fighting for survival.
Ahead on the cards when he was knocked out by David Tua. Ahead on the cards last November when he was knocked out here in Atlantic City by Oleg Maskayev. Here's a closer look at Haseem Rahman.
Has he lost because of stamina problems himself? He's lost both of those fights in late rounds. To get away from that syndrome, he's muscled up with some weightlifting, added 7 or 8 hard pounds. But will it do him any real good? Some of the people in his team don't think so. He has said if he cannot beat Corey Sanders, he will never fight again because that will tell him that he can't be a champion.
In July in London, Lennox Lewis is scheduled to defend the heavyweight title against Frans Botha of South Africa. So does that mean that Botha is the best South African heavyweight? Probably not. The title of best South African heavyweight almost certainly should go to this man, Corey Sanders. He's only lost once in his career, but look at the inactivity in which his career has been mired while he's been living way down in South Africa.
He's an outstanding athlete who simply has had a very comfortable life in South Africa, where he makes good money, fights about once a year, goes hunting, plays golf, never fully committed himself to being all that he could be as a fighter.
And a closer look at Corey Sanders.
Well, we told you he was an athlete, and as Jim put it, he can drive a golf ball 50 yards farther than Tiger Woods. He drives par fours, hits it 375 yards and more, is a 2-5 handicap. He fought both the four times in the amateurs, beat him every time, stopped him three times. And more of that power when he iced Ice Cole, a really rugged American heavyweight, in the very first round in his last fight.
And while you're watching both of our fights tonight, you can lob on to HBO.com/boxing, where you'll be able to score each round, spend some time chatting with former heavyweight contender Michael Bent, and answer the question, who in your mind can beat Lennox Lewis? We list four choices for you on the website: Tua, Tyson, Vladimir Klitschko, the younger brother, Roy Jones, or another choice open to you is none of the above. Or you can write in whichever heavyweight you think would be capable of beating Lennox Lewis. We'll tally up the results. Meanwhile, tail of the tape for Corey Sanders against Haseem Rahman. And you can see that the clock is ticking on Sanders' career at age 34. Rahman still by far the fresher face to the two at 27. Inch and a half height advantage for Sanders. Reach advantage of 2 pounds or 2 inches. Plus, he's that rarity, a heavyweight southpaw. And you may remember only one southpaw has ever won the heavyweight championship. That was Michael Moorer. Rules of the bout with our unofficial ringside scorer, Harold Lederman.
Jim, the Corey Sanders, Haseem Rahman fight is scheduled for 12 rounds using the unified rules on your screen in addition to the 10-point majority scoring system of Commissioner Larry Hazard. Jim, big controversy at the rules meeting yesterday. Haseem Rahman chose Reyes gloves. Corey Sanders refused to fight with Reyes gloves. Promoter Cedric Kushta had to go to Kansas City to bring in ringside gloves. So Sanders wears ringside 10 ounce. Rahman wears Reyes 10 ounce. Jim.
Let's go to ring announcer Michael Buffer for the official introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to Bally's Park Place Casino Resort here on the Boardwalk in Atlantic City, New Jersey, where tonight Cedric Kushner Promotions presents his heavyweight explosion on HBO Boxing After Dark. Presented in association with your undisputed, undefeated king of beers, Budweiser, proud to be your bud. Sanctioned by the New Jersey State Athletic Control Board, Boxing Commissioner Larry Hazard Sr. This first bout is brought to you in association also with Golden Gloves of South Africa. The three judges assigned to ringside scoring the bout will be Glenn Feldman, Eugene Grant, and John Potteray. And when the bell rings, the referee in charge of the action, Ed Cotton. And now from Bally's Park Place of Atlantic City, 12 rounds of boxing for the WBU World Heavyweight Championship. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing black trimmed with silver, his weight 245 pounds, and he stands 6'2" 1/2 inches tall. His professional record, 32 victories, including 26 knockouts with only 2 losses. From Baltimore, Maryland, ladies and gentlemen, here is the challenger, Haseem the Rahman. And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing white and weighing in at 225 pounds. He stands 6'4" tall. He brings a professional record consisting of 37 bouts with 36 victories, including 26 knockouts and only 1 defeat. Ladies and gentlemen, from Pretoria in the new South Africa, making his 4th title defense, presenting the reigning and defending WBU World Heavyweight Champion, Corey Sanders.
All right, boxers, you both received your instructions in the dressing room. Obey my commands, protect yourself a good time. Let's touch gloves, have a good clean fight.
Jim, I don't know anybody who even thinks they know what's gonna happen in these fights tonight. We're just gonna have to wait a few seconds more.
Yeah, you're right. There are any number of scenarios you can pick for this fight. Now, Sanders, after having knocked out Al Cole in the first minute and a half of his last fight on February 19th, And with all that inactivity, I expect him to try to start fast, Emmanuel.
Well, I definitely think that Sanders is the most skillful and faster between the two fighters. The thing is, a lot of guys who are used to fighting in their hometown, home countries, become a little bit unorganized and uncomfortable when they fight in different settings, such as him fighting here instead of fighting in South Africa. The fight's going to be interesting in more reason than one. First of all, I don't like the extra weight that Haseem has picked up. I think it's not that good for him at his height. And if that be the case, I think the speed factor could be a big factor for him.
That's Randy Cotton ruling a slip.
Yeah.
So Corey Sanders went down early.
But I think Corey is a very good technical fighter. There's a lot of speed. And if he feels very comfortable and relaxed in this setting right here, he could be very difficult for Haseem.
Of course, as you see, Sanders is a southpaw. And you've seen Rahman starting out trying to mount his attack behind the right-hand lead. That's a change for him. In the past, Rahman has been effective working off the jab. Now he backs Sanders into a corner and tries his hand at infighting.
Well, the fact that Sanders is permitted to fight inside, but he seems to have been in control of everything. I just think the hand speed of Sanders is going to be a big factor.
Sanders lands a short left hand, seems to wobble Rahman a bit. Rahman fighting out of the corner. Corey Sanders with his hands down, very relaxed in the early going against Haseem Rahman.
You know, we must remember that Rockman's last two major fights, he lost by knockout, and they were really some powerful knockouts. He was hurt very seriously with Tua, and also the fight when he was knocked out by Oleg Moskev. So, you know, I don't know what effect that may have on him in addition to the extra weight.
Yeah, he got launched by a right hand and came all the way through the ring ropes and landed on his head on concrete. You wonder, just the psychological hangover from that experience is a question mark.
Could be a big factor.
Rahman trying the 1-2 there. Sanders easily blocking the jab with his right hand. Rockman's going to have to resist the natural instinct to work off the left jab constantly against Sanders. There he goes, the left hook to the body, and Sanders fires a counter in return.
Sanders' speed seems to be a big factor in this fight at this point in time. And I think the fact that Rockman seemed to have slowed down even more so, I think the weight that he's gained, which he gained primarily from what I understand from lifting weights, is not healthy that much for his height.
Sanders looks a little softer around the belly, particularly compared to Rahman, but there's a hard left hand, and obviously softness around the belly does nothing to slow Corey Sanders' remarkable hand speed for such a big man.
Yeah, stuck it in. Now you got the little first round jitteries, you know what I mean? Start jabbing them twice. Hands up when you jab.
All right, let's go to work.
How you feel?
Good.
He's only trying to steer you on shots. That's all. Mm-hmm. Shut your mouth. Okay.
A left hand followed by that right hand by Rahman.
Box numbers in round number one, Sanders 15 out of 60, Rahman 15 out of 46. Most of the connections were power punches. In previous fights we watched on tape, Corey Sanders' corner, trainer Harold Volbrecht spoke to him in English. Thus, no Afrikaans interpreter. We were taken by surprise when they spoke Afrikaans in the corner at the end of round one.
Rahman has been primarily known throughout his career mostly as a right-hand puncher, which is good when you're fighting the southpaw, particularly because that's your best punch. And if he can land his right hand, he can possibly turn the fight around. But the fact that no guy, neither one of them are really effectively working with their jabs too much that are landing, they're just using it as more of a pawn type punch, which means that the speed element is going to be a big factor for Sanders, and the power punch, I think, primarily is going to be going for Rahman. And it's interesting, too, that Rahman
has been busier professional than Sanders, which looking at his record is really interesting that he has been very inactive. But the amateur career of Sanders was so much more extensive than that of Rockman, which to my knowledge didn't have much of an amateur career.
And there you saw the action as Rockman landed a big right hand counter after Sanders landed a left hand. Now Sanders trying to fire his left hand through Rockman's guard, and they trade punches in the corner. Corey Sanders looking to hit a double or a triple or maybe even a home run.
Okay. This is turning out to be a good fight here. Both guys are getting hit.
I think Sanders thinks he has Rockman in trouble.
Well, I think the fact that Rockman is laying in the ropes and going into a defensive mode is pretty much luring Sanders into believing that he hasn't hurt. But the biggest thing is to me still is the speed and the extra weight that Rockman has picked up, which I don't think is going to help him.
And you saw Rockman overcommit on a right hand, and Sanders was able to pop him with a quick left. That drove Rockman back into the ropes. Rockman is having to reach from way back with the right hand, and Corey Sanders is stepping up inside and taking advantage of those counter opportunities.
Yes, he is. And at this stage here,
there it was again.
Sanders is slowed down his footwork, and his speed is up from his hands, but not from his foot anymore. And as a result, I think this fight's going to turn out to be a slugfest.
Punch out, punch out, punch
well,
out!
If Rockman overcommits to one more right hand and Sanders can time the left right, we'll find out if Rock can take his punch.
Stop punch, stop punch, stop punch.
And there it is again, and this time Rockman's in trouble. Sanders pounding the left hand through the guard. Rockman wobbles back into the corner. Round two's about to come to a close. Not a second too soon for Haseem Rockman.
This is turning out to be an exciting heavyweight fight.
Rockman's new trainer, Adrian Davis, hurling him into the corner.
Kick the legs out. Kick the lean back. Give me some water. Give me the grease. Suck it in. Now, this is on your bottom, okay? You keep your hands up. You can only hit you when your hands down. Suck it in.
Put your hands down.
Suck it in. Give me some
water. Give me the water. Give me the mouthpiece.
Beautiful.
When he comes to fight me, Corey, okay? He ate him and he begged. That's fun.
Yes, let me start. Fine.
I'll be fine.
Rockman impressively came back from a short left hook with a right hand there. He is still rather fresh. Remember, when he suffered the knockouts, it was in late rounds where his stamina had been tested. But we're looking at Corey Sanders here, who loves to go big game hunting in South Africa, and he is going big game hunting right here in Atlantic City tonight.
Wouldn't it be fascinating to see Rockman fall behind early and win a fight by outlasting his opponent, as appears might have to be the case here. In round two, Corey Sanders was able to get off 76 punches to only 48 for Haseem Rockman. So Sanders has been the more active fighter in the first two rounds.
And also, if you notice, at the conclusion of a punch, whenever Rockman throws a punch, if he misses it, he falls off balance very much because of the excessive weight, I think. And Sanders seems to be a little bit sharp and more crisper with his footwork.
Now Sanders appears to be trying to get a little bit of rest in the first minute of round three, having thrown nearly 140 punches in the first two rounds. And Rockman has a chance to take advantage and does with a right-hand lead.
Rockman is gambling everything on his right hand lead, because that's his breadwinner. It has been throughout his career, but particularly in this fight here. He is not concentrating on his left hook or his jab at all. He's dependent entirely on one right hand.
This is a power punch fight, folks. It's going to be Haseem Rockman's right hand against Corey Sanders' left hand, and somebody's going to win this fight off their back foot.
And I think it's going to be pretty soon, too.
Body shot by Rockman.
It seems that Sanders is relaxed and he's only watching Rockman's right hand. If Rockman would come back with a left hook, I think he would have a lot more going for him. But Sanders is watching only the right hand of Rockman right now. And I think what he's really dependent on is making Rockman miss a right hand and then trying to counter with the left.
Neither man has gone to the body much. Rockman is obviously thinking about it in this round. Some body punching now.
He made it miss the left, right hand, and he counted with the left.
Absolutely. He timed it right that time. So there's the first knockdown of the fight as Rahman goes down and complains to referee Eddie Cotton that it shouldn't have been ruled a knockdown.
And he is wrong, of course, because the ropes held him up.
It was an explosive left hand off the missed right. Now Sanders tries to finish up with 30 seconds to go in the round and goes down himself on a counter right hand.
Yeah.
I think he's stunned as much as being hurt because he didn't see the punch. He was in the process of trying to finish off Rahman.
I don't know when I've seen a fighter walk to his corner and go down to his knee to rest. Bell sounded too early. Round hasn't ended. Oh, that wasn't the official bell. Somebody else sounded a bell of some sort. Well, that was confusing, but the fighters got through it okay, and what a round.
Pretty much as we expected.
You know, you're through, you just let it go. Just let it go.
Breathe in good.
Now, once you get your win, suck it in. This guy ain't got it. Soon you hit the head, you're going to go. Come on, suck it in. Give him some work on the back of his head. Come on.
What do you need to come stand and train me, sir, please?
Raj, you keep turning and stay away from his right hand.
Relax, books, books for the jet.
Watch the left right there coming in. Perfectly timed left hook by Sanders. And the ropes clearly holding him up. Sanders getting cocky here, trying to finish it. Leaves himself open. Rahman, to his credit, saw it and shot his right through.
So both men were down in the third. Go ahead, Larry.
Well, you wonder if Sanders has used himself up because of all his activity. He looks a little bit wobbly right at this moment.
And you wonder if Sanders suffers from ring rust at this point. All the years of inactivity, so many short fights. And now he catches Rahman again with the left. And Rahman tries to catch him with the right. This is just going to be an old-fashioned slugfest from here on in. And they almost both went down.
Yeah, but... But Rahman held on to the ropes to break his fall.
Six.
Sanders looking confused now as he looks at his corner to Harold Bulbrecht. Long way to go in this round. Corey Sanders, hands are down. He may be done in.
Rahman is looking for the big right hand. And every time he throws a right hand, Sanders tries to counter with his left. And when Sanders gets caught, it's when he's going in, being aggressive. He never gets hit too much when he's in a counterpunching mode.
Sanders with one more glance over to his corner as though there's something that Bulbrecht can tell him that'll help him out of this mess. Sanders has been down twice. Rockman's been down once.
Well, they've seen a lot of stuff on the boardwalk in Atlantic City. I don't know the last time they saw something like this.
I know. Derek Jefferson against Maurice Harris last November 6th. Same kind of fight. Boxing after dark, heavyweight fireworks. Sanders looks like he's in another world, but Rahman hasn't been able to take advantage in the last minute.
Rahman is looking to throw his right hand and try to hit it, and Sanders is trying to make him throw the right hand and trying to counter with the left. There it is again. Every time he makes him throw the right, he tries to counter.
One body shot, two body shots, three body shots. One of them was low. Sanders looks utterly done in. Loses his footwork for a moment.
Sanders has made it known that his second biggest love is golf, and maybe it might become his biggest love after this, because it's totally just the opposite of what he's in tonight.
They trade shots again.
Blood coming from both of their noses in this fight. Why not?
Corey Sanders beginning to get his legs back from the knockdown early in the round. But Haseem Rahman was never able to find the right finishing opportunity for 2 minutes there while Sanders wandered around in a daze.
If Rahman would use his jab a little bit more effective, I think he would do a lot better. It would set up better for his right hand.
Wild left hand misses by Sanders. and they'll go to another round.
The boy's dead time. You got him back up. Back up with one. Okay, let's do this. One strong jab.
We almost had
a
double knockdown in that round. Just watch as Rockman throws the right hand, catches him, but held himself up with that left hand, which was fortunate because it gave him a 2-point round.
I thought that's what might happen in the second fight tonight. I actually said in one of our pre-fight promos on the air that Moskov and Jefferson might knock each other out. Instead, it was Rockman and Sanders who almost pulled that off. Corey Sanders threw 70 punches around in the first two rounds of this fight. In the last round, by CompuBox numbers, he threw 38. So Sanders has lost his activity level and is now just looking for a one-punch knockout of Rockman. Harold, how do you have it through four?
Hawk Edge, an interesting scoring. Actually, in rounds 2-1-1, Corey Sanders, but in points, it's all even. The first two rounds, like you said, Corey Sanders wins 10-9. The third round, they each scored a knockdown. You really have to score it even, 10-10. And the fourth round, Rock wins 10-8 because of the clean knockdown. 38-38, even.
I think Rockman's got a chance to win a boxing match if he can pull his act together and just go from here working with the right hand.
Well, it's clear that Sanders is trying to get his second or third wind here, and Rockman doesn't seem capable of putting the pressure on him.
At this stage right here, Rockman should really step up the pressure a lot more.
How do you explain what Rockman did in the last 2 minutes of the preceding round and here?
Well, basically, it's a gambling fight, the winner of the fight. And they're both just gambling. One is shooting the right hand lead, and the other is waiting to counterpunch over the right. But if you notice, Sanders threw a few pesky right jabs that seemed to have been effective. But if he doesn't continue to do that, Rockman is going to keep walking straight into him. He needs to keep working his right jab a little bit more to keep him at a distance right there and to set him up for his left. But Rockman seems to have gotten his confidence back together, seems to be very comfortable in the setting right now. But what bothers me is the fact that he's doing the same thing over and over, strictly trying to throw a right hand.
Round five is a totally arm-weary round for both fighters. Neither man has landed anything of significance here. Pesky jabs, as you called them, Emmanuel. The best that Corey Sanders can offer. He's waiting for Rockman to throw another right hand, getting ready to drop the left on him. And Rockman's looking for the spot to throw the right hand. Crowd wants action, and for the moment, they're not going to get it.
A fan who boos this fight ought to be throttled. They've earned a break.
That was a good jab by Rockman.
Well, call it the fifth inning stretch, if you like. Tune in July 17 as HBO Sports presents our next Sports of the 20th Century documentary, When It Was a Game 3. Once again in our award-winning series, viewers will be taken back to an era when fans had special bonds with their heroes. The 1960s were a time of turbulent change, but throughout the decade, names like Clemente, Gibson, Mays, Mantle, and Aaron still meant greatness. When It Was a Game 3, with its exclusive home movies, premiering in July on HBO.
Just you doing this now. Back him up, fade him back. And look, every time something ain't right, put the hands up.
I breathe in good, man.
He's loping the wall, Hussein. That's just, don't let him move. You make me get this grease. Don't move. All right.
Your title, let's go.
Round 5 totally unlike any of its predecessors. All of the four preceding rounds dominated by power punches. In round 5, Rockman threw 21 jabs and landed 8. And Sanders also connected on, actually connected on 9 jabs. So both fighters got whatever offense they got in the 5th round from the jab, and it was precious little. Let's see who gets the second win first.
Both guys seem to be mentally alert, though, and seem to be trying to sort things out, so to say. I think the jab is becoming more of a factor as the fight is moving on. And once again, maybe they've rested up, they're ready to resume where they left off a couple of rounds ago.
Rockman lands a straight left hand. Sanders looks fresh enough to counter with the left. Rockman is more effective when they get inside. And this time, Sanders takes the right hand lead, flush on the jaw.
Sanders got a pretty good, he's been hit with some good right hand. I think the knockdowns, when he got knocked down, was mainly when he was in the process of punching. It wasn't expecting punches at the time. But he seemed to have a pretty good chin. But the fight is up for grabs. Whoever could mount a good aggressive attack, particularly behind a jab right now, could take control of the fight. Same again.
Another counter left hand by Sanders. Sanders getting more and more pesky with that jab now, trying to set up his left hand, and he lands 2 more left crosses on Rockman. Misses the third.
Sanders has a tendency to get square with his balance once he gets into an exchange.
Go to the corner. Who's mouth? We got the mouthpiece?
Haseem Rockman losing the mouthpiece. It's right in front of New Jersey State Athletic Commission Chairman Larry Hazard.
Sanders. Sanders lost
Sanders' mouthpiece. Yeah, okay.
Rockman has one of those clear mouthpieces, which looks like it's nothing in his mouth, but it has a clear mouthpiece.
You heard Eddie Cotton asking Rockman if it was his mouthpiece, and you're right. Turns out to be Sanders' mouthpiece instead.
Let's go. Let's go.
Rockman going to the body with the right hand. I like that idea. This fight, incidentally, is scheduled for 12 rounds because Corey Sanders owns an off-brand heavyweight title belt.
Let's go, get out.
It's not even an off-brand. It's not even an off-brand. Hard right hand by Rockman. Sanders is taking that punch now.
Stop punching, stop punching. Step back.
Both guys, strange enough, seem to have rejuvenated themselves, at least mentally. I'm looking at both of them guys. They seem to be very clear. They're very much aware of everything that's going on. And the biggest problem I see that Sanders has is his balance. After he throws a punch, he often finds himself squared with his feet, so therefore he gets knocked down very easily.
I don't see his hand speed anymore, man.
No more hand speed. But nevertheless, the pesky jab of his is still beginning to be a big factor, particularly if he keeps it up.
That was a big round for Rockman. And still to come, the other heavyweight battle, the one we thought would really provide the fireworks, and maybe it will. Derek Jefferson against Oleg Maskeyev. Maskeyev, last November, was trailing Rockman on all cards when he knocked him through the ropes here in Atlantic City.
Yeah, spin it around, suck it in deep. Get your hands down, Rock. Relax, baby. He's running from you, Rock. Can't you see him? Press it, look. Left foot. Keep back to back with the hands up. Do like this. He can't get nothing. And you jam.
All right. All right.
He's
good. All right. Just step it up a
minute. All right. There you see in the back of the arena here is Corey Sanders' wife, a 3-year-old daughter who is celebrating her 3rd birthday tonight. A few rounds ago, they were sitting ringside, but Mrs. Sanders decided that this is may not be the kind of thing her daughter would want to see.
Good choice. Interesting fight halfway through. Harold Letterman's card even. CompuBox numbers fairly even. Sanders 110 out of 302. Rockman 113 out of 277. Rockman landing slightly fewer power punches. Sanders uses the jab more than Rockman does.
when they both exchange their power punches at the same time, meaning Rockman throws a right hand, Sanders throws a left, Rockman seems to have the advantage. He seems to get his right hand in a little bit faster. But when Sanders is effective, it's after he lets Rockman miss. But when they shoot at the same time, Rockman seems to come in a little bit better. His punch seems to be a little bit more to the inside. But the big difference would be still if Rockman would use his left jab a lot more.
Sanders also seems to be strictly a head puncher.
That's correct.
Doesn't work to the body at all.
Doesn't punch to the body at all.
And Oleg Moskev was saying to us yesterday that he felt the importance of working in American gyms was that you learn the left hook and you learn to use body punches.
And you learn to use body punches. In most of the countries, even though South Africa is not Europe, they still primarily concentrate on head punches.
Straight right hand by Rockman, right on the button. And a right, and a left, and a big rally. And Sanders tries to hold on. And Rockman just pounding away. Sanders covering up, covering up, covering up. Rockman just punching, punching.
What's
Eddie Cotton looking in.
What's Sanders?
Eddie Cotton's going to stop it.
Yes.
Corey Sanders not defending himself.
And that's
as Haseem Rockman punches him right out of the division.
Punched him right out. He should have grabbed the man and tied him up. When you're hurt like that, grab the thing that's punching and beating you up. Grab the arms and tie the arms up.
But he was hit by about 15 to 17 straight punches.
Unanswered.
And early on, he seemed dazed. Just trying to survive the onslaught, but not doing anything to get out of the way.
Well, the referee had no choice. When you're getting hit that much and you're not returning any punches, he has to stop the fight.
Gentlemen, it appeared that once Corey Sanders was unable to get the early knockout against Haseem Rockman, it became a matter of time and whether Rockman would destroy himself or take advantage of the opportunity in front of him. Instead, he took advantage.
He took advantage of it, and in fact, he fought as if he wanted to win a little bit more than Sanders going down the stretch. The fight was up in there.
33 wins now against only two losses for Rockman. He takes a big step toward reviving his status as a contender in the division. And Corey Sanders, in all likelihood, will go back to South Africa without ever getting a shot at one of the top heavyweights of his time, Lennox Lewis or Mike Tyson or Evander Holyfield. Sanders will console himself with having won a minor league title and having had a big record, particularly when fighting at home in South Africa. And here's another replay, and Emmanuel Sanders just never tried to hold on.
No, he never tried to hold on, you know. And when you're hurt like that, you can't see punches that good. The best thing to do is to grab the guy and grab the arms that's beating on you. But in his case, probably not experienced at being hurt like that before. He didn't know what to do because originally he wasn't hurt to the degree where he could not have survived probably. But right now, at this point in time, when you're hurt like that, even punches that's landed on the side of your head on the gloves, they still vibrate through and they cause a lot of damage.
Sanders' only previous loss was a knockout by Nate Tubbs way back in 1994. It's been 6 years since he lost a fight. Almost 6 years to the day, in fact, because that was May 21 of 94. This loss probably seals his fate as a marginal heavyweight contender who was discussed in relation to a lot of big fights and written about in relation to a lot of big fights through the 90s, but never really got there.
Yes, well, I think right now at this point in time in his career, he'll have to be resigned to the fact that he was a WBU champion and have to accept that, and that's going to be his biggest claim to fame.
And maybe he can get that handicap back down to two. There's his wife and daughter. Let's go to Michael Buffer for the official particulars on the knockout.
Ladies and gentlemen, part one of the Cedric Kushner heavyweight explosion on HBO Boxing After Dark comes to an end at 1 minute, 50 seconds of round number seven. The winner by knockout victory and new WBU World Heavyweight Champion, Haseem the Rock Rockman.
Final punch stat numbers. Haseem Rockman said that if he couldn't beat Corey Sanders, he would give up trying to become heavyweight champion of the world. So Rockman will continue his pursuit of a potential title, landing 150 total punches to 118 for Sanders.
throwing more, connecting at a higher percentage, rallying in the last couple of rounds of the fight, and eventually putting Sanders away after Sanders seemingly totally ran out of petrol. And power punches, as I said, Sanders is the only man who threw jabs, and Rockman landed 37 punches to only 8 for Sanders in that last round, so the numbers bulged as the result of the Rockman rally. Larry Merchant standing by with the winner.
All right, thank you, Jim. Congratulations, Rock.
Thank you, Mr. Merchant.
You had a rocky beginning to this fight. How did you fight your way out of it?
Well, that's smooth sailing from the end of my last fight. What are you talking about, Rocky? First of all, I'd like to say, Allahu Akbar, God is the greatest. No, there's no strength, no power except with God. And God gave me the strength to do that. And I love you, Hassam, Jr. and Sharif, in the mirror. All right, go ahead.
All right. You said before the fight that if you couldn't beat Corey Sanders, it meant you would never put on the gloves again.
I absolutely meant it.
And was that the intense motivation you had in there, even while you were getting strafed by him in the first couple of rounds?
I felt like I was giving as good as I was taking. He would land one, but he wasn't landing combinations. You understand? Because I kept my head moving a little better, and I would also stun him occasionally with a good shot and make him back up and retreat. The man comes all the way over here. He talked trash to me yesterday at the glove meeting, telling me he's the champion. I wear what gloves he wear, and you know, he made it a little personal. A little more personal than it had to be. So he had to get dealt with.
So we will see you again in the ring.
Well, most definitely, I'd like to fight the winner of this next upcoming fight. I'm J.R. Jefferson, my man, but if he give her the mask, me and Jefferson got to get it on.
All right, thank you very much.
Make that fight, Murphy.
Congratulations, Rock. I wish I had the power to do so. Jim.
All right, Rockman doing a little matchmaking there in the ring. The judges saw it all the same way. Rockman was leading 58-55. On the master scorecard at the time of the knockout. Emmanuel, the big question coming into the fight was, could Rock exorcise the demons from his two late round knockouts against Tua and Maskayev? How much will this help in getting rid of the psychological hangover from the two losses?
I think tonight that Rockman became a really seasoned fighter, so to say. I think he was in a tough fight that he survived and came back and won. I think he became a veteran fighter tonight, and I think it's going to help him going down the stretch.
All right, so we'll see if Hasim Rockman can position himself for a shot at Emmanuel's man, Lennox Lewis, the heavyweight champion of the world. But when we come back, we'll be giving you the second of our two main events, the live battle between Oleg Maskayev, the Russian from Kazakhstan, and Derek Jefferson out of Detroit. Right now, let's look ahead to some upcoming programs on HBO.